Welcome back. So, if government strives for a future of electric vehicles powered by renewable energy, what measures should it take? Given the vested interests of established stakeholders and the uncertainties about technological innovation and many other uncertainties, which policies should be designed now to bring the future mobility system into being? What policy interventions may be effective to change the established energy and mobility system into a future zero emission system? In shaping the future mobility system, policymakers have to take into account three different dimensions. First, there is the physical or technical dimension, which includes all the technical components of the clean mobility system, such as the electric vehicles themselves, but also the power generation facilities and the charging infrastructure for electric vehicles. Second, there is the social dimension of the system, which includes all the actors in the system, such as the users of electric vehicles, the users of electricity, the power producers, the car manufacturers, electricity and road network operators, and many more. Besides the physical system, the social system is crucial in creating the conditions for electric mobility to unfold. And we will discuss some of the actors that play a role and discuss how they interact with each other and with the physical system. Then the third dimension that we discuss is the institutional dimension. Institutions govern the interactions between the physical components, between the actors in the social dimension, but most importantly, institutions govern the interactions between the social and the physical components of the mobility system. But first, we are going to build a picture of the physical dimension. How is that system supposed to work? We envisage a large share of variable renewable energy resources in the future power system, mainly wind and solar. At the moment, the share of renewables in the power generation mix differs a lot between countries, and very few countries are close to the ideal situation of a fully renewable power system, with the exception, I think, of Norway, thanks to its excellent geographic conditions for hydropower. However, not all countries are in such favorable conditions. Let's compare, for example, Denmark, Germany, and France. Germany has been investing a lot of money in the so-called Energiewende, the transition to renewable energy, especially to wind and solar power. But the fact is that it still relies to a large extent on coal and lignite-fired power plants. France has less fossil-fired power plants and much more nuclear power in its electricity generation portfolio. But the share of renewable energy resources is much smaller than in Germany. Denmark, however, has made tremendous progress in greening its electricity generation portfolio, with massive investments in offshore wind energy backed up with flexible gas-fired power plants. Already on windy days, Denmark can fully run on wind power, making the residual load zero. And during times of excess wind power supply, the supply surplus can be exported thanks to Denmark's cross-border connections with Sweden, Germany, Norway, and with new interconnectors to Great Britain and the Netherlands in the future. However, the wind is not always blowing and the sun is not always shining. Given a future electricity system in which variable renewable energy sources play a more dominant role, uncertainty about production is increasing, no matter how many researchers are working on improving the local meteorological forecasts. So, what are the main design variables for countering the residual load problem? We will briefly treat the flexibility options: flexible power plants, demand response, and storage. First, let us elaborate the option of flexible power plants. These are power plants that can be ramped up or down to adjust their power output to the supply of electricity from variable renewable resources. Flexible power plants produce so-called dispatchable power, in contrast with solar panels or wind turbines. The latter are totally weather dependent, and their output can only be influenced negatively by curtailment. Not all traditional power plants are equally flexible, however. Nuclear power plants take a long time to start up and shut down, and are therefore best used to supply base load. Coal-fired plants are more flexible than nuclear plants, and more modern coal-fired plants are quite flexible, but generally are not flexible enough to supply peak power. Ramping up or down takes hours rather than minutes. But gas-powered plants can be started up within minutes and can provide peak power. Currently, most national transmission system operators have quite a wide range of options for dispatchable power at their disposal, with different time constants, which enables them to balance generation and load, even if part of the generation portfolio is weather-dependent. In the future system, however, as wind and solar power become more dominant, become really dominant in the power mix, the need for short-term flexibility in the system is going to increase tremendously. The power system will need more gas-fired power plants and more interconnection capacity to meet the flexibility needs of the future. And by the way, in a renewable energy future, in a zero-emission future, the gas to fire thermal power plants is not meant to be natural gas, of course. Instead, you should think of biogas or hydrogen. Now, an alternative option is to seek the required flexibility on the demand side of the power system rather than on the supply side. If the wind is not blowing and the sun is not shining, we could reduce the demand for electricity. And this is the so-called demand response strategy. So rather than adjusting power production, we can adjust demand to the fluctuating supply of wind and solar power. And this option, demand response, is especially relevant for electric vehicles, as the use of an electric vehicle entails a substantial electricity demand. Now, for an average Dutch household, an electric vehicle more or less doubles the annual electricity demand, which is currently 3,500 kilowatt hours per year. Many electric vehicle users connect their vehicle at home to be recharged after office hours. But this time coincides with the daily peak in electricity demand. And of course, they only need their car fully charged the next morning. So shifting this battery recharging demand to the night time could be a much more efficient way to deal with the residual load problem. From a physical system perspective, this implies that we need battery electric cars and charging stations, as well as information and communication systems that accommodate such smart charging. The third and last option to meet the flexibility needs of the future power system is the use of energy storage facilities. Energy storage is, call it, the missing link in the current power system. It's not entirely, but largely missing, because the current power system almost fully relies on dispatchable power production. So if we want to get rid of fossil-fired power plants in the future, energy storage will be indispensable to solve the temporal variability of renewable energy resources. We will need storage when renewable power supply exceeds load, and we will need storage to supply energy when renewable power supply falls short. Possible options are using large-scale batteries, pumped hydro storage, and chemical storage. Pumped hydro storage is available in some countries, including Norway, but its capacity is limited and may be subject to seasonal fluctuations. In the case of chemical storage, excess power from renewable sources may be used to electrolyze water, thus producing hydrogen that can either be combusted as a transport fuel or be used to feed fuel cells for conversion into electricity. Then the last option, battery storage, it's really expensive, but it provides short-term flexibility for the power system, as batteries can deliver energy back to the power grid when needed within seconds or even faster. Wrapping up, so far we have looked at the physical dimension of the power and mobility system. In the next lectures, we will have a deeper look into the interactions between the actors in the social dimension of the system and into the institutions shaping these interactions.